Hey guys, welcome to the TechPoint Africa podcast. My name is Emmanuel.
I'm Oluwani Femi.
I'm Jim Godwin.
And I'm Bolu.
Yeah, Bolu, welcome back.
Thank you.
How was your trip?
It was fine.
To the Asian city.
Yeah, it was lovely.
It was lovely.
It was nice to
see you. I didn't bring anything. Again. Come back. No problem. I see you. Yeah, so it's been an animated week. A lot of things happening in the country. And we've been arguing here in the studio for almost an hour before we started recording. Talking about Nigeria and the problems. And
when you got
an adulthood, yes.
And the scam.
And all this scam. But underneath everything, we just know that it's money. Money is the main crux of the issue. There's money. Almost of the, we don't even have time to be arguing. Spending money and all of that, right? And yeah, talking about money. I'm hearing money is flowing again. They said it was dried up. But I'm hearing money is flowing into the ecosystem.
Mm-hmm. Rainy season is back.
Rainy season is back. Well, these rains have been terrible. But yeah, Chingozirim.
Yes, so
please, if we need to take it out with a pinch of salt, just let us know.
Well, I don't know. So you listen to this podcast and then you make up your mind. Jump to any conclusions that you like. But so basically, we were discussing earlier today and Bolu was commenting that looks like funding stories are like coming at us back to back, and it's because I don't know, but for a while it looked like nobody was announcing their raises. And in the context of a global downturn in VC funding, I guess the question is, are African startups actually feeling it? This is probably 2 or 3 months since we started hearing whispers of reduced funding or something. So I don't know. There's really no indication. Others are laying off, but we've not really heard of an African startup has laid off staff, and we can't also assume that nobody is doing that. According to a tweet I saw, this a lot of people are actually doing it, but it's like flying under the radar. Maybe not a lot, but like some people are doing it, but it's flying under the radar. So this week, in the last 1 week, we've had about 7 startups raise a combined $78.2 million, and that's actually impressive when you consider that other parts of the world they've had like reduced funding in Q1 2022.
Okay.
Europe, US, Asia, they've had less money coming into the ecosystem. So the only two guys that are still standing strong is Africa and Latin America. So according to Africa, the big deal, a new monthly record has been set all through 2022. Oh. So January 2022 has been the best January ever since we started recording funding in Africa. So January 2021 was definitely not better than January 2022. January 2020, January 2019, 2018 and all. It hasn't been as good as January 2022. So
okay.
Yeah. Those are like things to be, let's say, excited about, because it looks like these things are not happening. But something is curious there. Nigeria, Kenya, Egypt, South Africa, they are like the major people that get this funding. But Kenya and Egypt have experienced significantly more growth than Nigeria. So Kenya has had 46% growth in VC funding coming to them. Egypt is like second with 212%, and our dear giant of Africa has just 154%. They are growing, but for a country that was the top destination for VC funding, destination for VC funding, that I think is low. I don't know, some people may have a different opinion. I think it's low.
So you're saying Nigeria may no longer be the top destination for VC funding?
Yes,
in 2022.
That's what it's looking like. I mean, you're not growing as fast as other people. So there's the argument to be made that you've led the way, and sustaining that growth might be a bit difficult. But these guys are coming up, and they are not just... it's not like it's slight changes. They're making serious changes. So there's an argument to be made that we've had less money coming into Nigerian startups. And I don't know if there's any relation to the fact that this is 2022, just 7 or 8 months
before the election.
Before the election, so are investors worried? Are they holding back their checks and all?
Maybe they're being cautious or something. That makes a lot of sense. And I think now two things are standing out. I mean, this week we saw Headtracker raising
$1.5 million.
That's massive, and for a health tech startup and for a woman-led startup, right? Mm. So, but I think at this point, while we're celebrating the little wins we're seeing, we should be a little bit more critical about the funding news in the ecosystem. I mean, the ecosystem has reached that point where, okay, you've raised money, so what? Mm. Now we should actually seriously start interrogating that. Yeah. And I think that's something we're going to start addressing. For instance, you say Egypt has witnessed growth, but how many of those Egyptian startups are really African startups?
Mm. Okay, that's
most of them are mostly focused on East Africa, the Middle East, right? Yeah. Kenya is great, but how many of those startups would you call African startups? And I'm not going to go there.
Because we have to define what an African startup is.
Yes. So I'm not going to even go there at all. And it's quite an interesting conversation. And in the next few months, in the next few weeks, you should start seeing a shift in tone to our approach. I mean, we've largely ignored funding news in recent podcasts. So I think we should change.
Yes.
People are still excited about funding news, are we? Okay, yeah. let's just take a different approach to it.
Because everybody thinks the fact that you're raising money is like really good news. And yes, it is. I mean, if you're raising money, it means you're able to sell a very good story to someone.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter how wrong that story is. But yeah, you're able to sell a very good story to someone. So we now have to find out, okay, you've sold the story, but what was the content of that story, and is this something you can actually do?
So fundraisings are mostly the validation of successful storytelling.
Exactly. Yeah, not I saw a tweet this morning about because the thing is, I don't know, we do Pitch Friday every week, right? Sorry, every month. I said every week. We do Pitch Friday once a month, right?
Yes.
And we get to see at least two startup founders pitch. And some people pitch and everybody in the room is so animated. Others pitch and you're like, what the hell is this guy doing? Right? So now that's you who doesn't have to commit his money. Mm-hmm. You're not interested. But some people pitch and then you're on the edge of your seat. You want to ask them questions. You want to know what they are doing. So I'm imagining it's the same for investors. They may claim to be very rational people, but we know that humans are not that rational. So the ability to tell them something nice, tell them a very nice story, could actually help you a lot. So yeah, it's important that we actually look at it. There's this thing I've seen some people do, they like explore pitch decks of startups. Fortunately, nobody will give you that pitch deck in this country. I would love to see what is on their pitch deck. Like, what the hell do you tell these investors? So it'd be interesting.
Yeah, so yeah. I would actually love to see what is on Elon Musk's pitch deck.
I bet you there's nothing. It's actually a Google Doc. Is his Google Doc?
What is there? Is his name?
Like, yes. What is he telling his investors at every quarterly meeting or annual general meeting?
Have you met
his Twitter
Elon
followers
Musk?
Are growing.
Oh, come on.
I mean, that's a valid KPI.
A valid KPI. What is he telling? How is he communicating with his board and telling them that, okay, Tesla stock crashed this week, but it's not because of my tweet. How does he want to communicate that?
He uses iMessage. He uses text them.
I hope it's not the same way he communicates with his Twitter followers.
No, it's not the same. It's not the same. He has to probably bring them inside a WhatsApp group and then he now does broadcast message. I'd be like, guys, this is what you've achieved. Like,
If you're listening and you're wondering why we are creeping about Elon Musk, if you're a crypto trader or a crypto startup in Africa, somehow, even though there should be no effect, somehow, Elon Musk's tweets affect you.
Yes.
So
it affects us.
It affects Boldu's net worth.
Yes. So yeah, Elon Musk is back at it again. It's not a new thing for Elon Musk to give his 1 or 2 cents. Is it even 1 or 2 cents? He says a lot about cryptocurrencies, which, you know, in the end usually really affect those cryptocurrencies. So what he's doing now is now saying he's still committed to Dogecoin. But before we continue, I think, you know, we need a moment of silence, you know. Observe a moment of silence for the crypto crash.
Why?
Guess about you guys.
That occurred last weekend. It was
people crazy. Are traumatized already.
Yes, it was crazy.
So no wonder you've been so quiet today. I wanted to ask you if you're okay.
I'm not
book therapy.
I'm not but so Elon Musk is not.
What's going on? What's going on?
Elon Musk is saying he is committed to Dogecoin. So if you remember, Elon Musk has always been a big fan of Dogecoin.
Okay.
And he has been tweeting a lot, saying a lot about it.
Mm.
But in recent times, we've not really heard him say so much. But now he's coming out saying he's still committed to it. And he's even saying he's buying Dogecoin.
Okay, so how does it affect crypto traders?
All right. So in the history of Elon Musk talking about cryptocurrencies, something always happens. Though I would say the effect of his tweets on cryptocurrencies have reduced, but with this recent one he did, there was actually a 25% jump in the price of Dogecoin, and that was after a 30% drop last weekend. So the I think the most interesting part about this story is the fact that he was just slammed with a 258 billion naira lawsuit.
Naira or dollars?
Dollars.
Okay.
$258 billion lawsuit.
Okay.
In naira, that's around 171 trillion naira.
All right, you didn't need to mention the naira, but yeah, you actually need to mention it for our audience.
Yes, yes, he was slammed with that lawsuit, and it was for the same reason. It was because of what he's doing now. Now he's talking about, I'm still on the Dogecoin bandwagon. He's doing all that. And the person that slammed him with the lawsuit was saying he's filing this lawsuit because Elon Musk told me about Dogecoin. Told me Dogecoin is good. I lost money on Dogecoin. Elon Musk has to pay. But it's really funny, and I don't know. It's hard to take the lawsuit seriously. It's an interesting story. But it's hard to take it seriously. I mean, $258 billion. Is Elon Musk even that rich?
Okay. So, but I think the main thrust of this story now, I'm looking at it, is my faith in the crypto market got really, really, really
shaky
when I started seeing that one individual could influence what happens in an entire market. Yeah. I mean,
in a decentralized market.
Like, so one individual, two individuals.
Yes.
Once one person says, oh, I'm pro crypto, the market goes up. Once another person says, oh, I'm not doing crypto again, the market goes down. And the market has gone so down. And I think, of course, it's not just unique to crypto.
Yeah.
The entire stock market is actually crashing.
Yes.
But companies are now laying off. Coinbase laying off thousands of staff.
Yes, crypto.com.
Yes. So
the same thing.
If the market is so volatile, and for the fact that, okay, people's livelihood could be dependent on someone's tweet.
Okay, the answer to
I need
that,
to get to, I really need to get to that level. Like, imagine me wiping out 10% from your network just because I tweeted.
Yeah, you sound like
there's levels to this power.
Why are you this proud?
I like using
no, it's sounding like somebody that if he has small power like this,
I will use it anyhow.
You. How
you people will not be walking on the same road with me?
Oh my god.
Okay, just in case you are listening to this, in case Chim Gozirim comes out to vie for any political position,
we will not endorse you.
Please. Don't endorse
we
me.
Won't endorse him.
Is Elon Musk running for presidency?
Thank God.
And he's still doing people that.
Okay.
This podcast is on the internet.
he never forgets.
Exactly. Yeah. So to your question about how, you know, some individuals can easily affect, you know, what happens in the crypto market. I like using an explanation by Quidax CEO Buchi Okoro. when he says that the reason why the crypto market is the way it is because it's actually a very small asset class. So imagine the crypto market as a bucket, right? It's a bucket. If you put water in a bucket and then say you put a baby inside that bucket, the water rises, mm-hmm. right? If you put an adult in that bucket, the water will rise easily, even more. Mm-hmm. And then you start seeing the water. But then once the adult comes out of it, the level drops, right? That's the crypto market. For other kind of asset class, say the stock market, it's more like a swimming pool or even an ocean. If you throw an adult human being inside it, it really has no effect.
Really?
Right? Yeah.
Individuals can come together, right, to manipulate the stock market.
Yes.
Yes.
That happened.
That happens. That's happened.
That
a lot.
Happened yeah, so, during the. Yeah, that actually happened when some guys on Reddit.
On Reddit, yeah.
Yes, actually, they did the investors who shorted GameStop stock. They did them really bad, you know. Yes, we've seen that happen before, but it takes a lot more when it comes to stock market. It takes a lot more because the crypto market entire market cap is less than $1 trillion. The stock market is way, 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 way greater, right? So in situations like that, you have, and most people in the crypto market are actually retail investors. Retail investors are not as knowledgeable. They are not, you don't have that much experts in this space. And then it's not a space that you can really, you know, do your fundamental analysis and this and get, sometimes you get it wrong. It has not become as one regulated as the stock market. It has not become as, it's a lot more volatile. So it's actually easier for few people to be able to control it, either controlling it with their influence or controlling it with their money. And then when they control with their influence, they're influencing people like me, Emmanuel, to go and buy. And then when
you have to mention my name, no problem.
And then when we do that in good numbers, you see crypto prices start going up, right? Mm-hmm. And then when maybe one big man does $120 billion somewhere decide to just enter one market, the stock market, the crypto market will go up. If it comes out,
it crashes.
Everybody will cry.
Okay.
Right. So I think that's the best way to explain why the crypto market is easily controlled. Well, someone can just do something, say something, and everybody start jumping up.
Mm. Okay. Yeah. I think it makes sense. Thinking about it, I think, in this instance, if you're a CEO or a co-founder and you're listening to this podcast, and you should rapidly realize that this is not just limited to Elon Musk. The stuff you put on the internet mm-hmm. actually affect how people perceive your business
yeah.
and business you should support. And the more your followers increase, the more you need to be more deliberate about how you communicate with your audience.
Exactly.
And the more you need to actually control, you have to be more deliberate about how your employees communicate with your audience and prospective customers. Everybody could be a customer. They could actually play a role in the success or downfall of your business. Mm. So if you actually want to learn how to use stellar and effective communication technologies to scale your business, both internally and externally, everything that has to do with communications, the entire spectrum, join us at the Tema Elevate Conference on July 23rd for conversations, really, really solid conversations that will reshape the way we do business. So yeah, that's I really wanted to point out and put it out there, right?
Mm-hmm.
So join us at the Tema Elevate Conference. It's Tema Elevate 1.0, July 23rd. And we'll be putting a link in the description for you to register. Now, yeah. So, Bolu, thank you very much. I don't have much to drag for you today. You've been surprisingly objective.
Yes, yes.
You've been surprisingly objective about the crypto market, but I still think we are wasting our time.
That's in sugar, that's right.
Oh, okay. So you guys are thinking, yeah, I like the balance. Yeah,
you know, everything that is happening right now is actually, to me, I think it's a testament to the fact that growth in the crypto market is actually occurring. People might see it as you know, something crazy, something weird. But I actually think it's a sign of
this
growth.
This guy is here optimistic.
Okay, me, I'm still waiting for Bitcoin to reach 2,000 so I can top up.
No.
$1,000.
By the deep, on the deep, deep
I rebuke it.
$100 in the bot.
You say I rebuke it.
$100, yeah, just top up from there.
You guys are wicked.
I feel you use my house rent.
Yes, you just suicide note everywhere.
Suicide note everywhere.
Come on.
Don't worry, there are startups for you now. You do mental health.
You do therapy, right?
And you'll be fine.
But think about it. If I was a startup founder, I'll be in crypto, Discord channels, Telegram. I could be plugging in my services. Call us for mental health therapy. Now, this is free marketing advice. I would advise that you take it very seriously.
Yeah, effective communication. Yes. So, there are so many, many things to talk about here. And we have to pick one. And I have to pick one that concerns a lot of people. Way more people than the crypto market. Way more people. I'm sorry. Which is the entertainment industry. Dear Nollywood. Amazon is making some interesting moves. That is reminiscent of what Netflix has done in the past. So Chinguzim has more details.
Oh, yes. So Amazon was, okay, they've gotten it. They are gradually getting into Nigeria, but they want to show, like they want to put their money where their mouth is. That's how you say it, right?
Yes. Okay. Yes.
So they want to put their money where their mouth is, and they are basically backing local local production. So they've gotten into a deal with a local company. I'm trying to pronounce their name.
Nemsia Films.
Okay. So they've signed a deal, a slate deal with them. So basically, they'll be financing some of their movies, about four movies, and these movies are expected to be produced. The production process should start sometime this year. And run until next year. So by Q1 2023, the first of those movies should be out in the cinemas. So I think we spoke about Amazon getting into the e-commerce market in Africa a few days ago. And now they are getting into the entertainment industry. Netflix has been there for a while.
Yeah.
Who else?
But Amazon has had eyes in Nollywood.
For
I think
a bit.
since past 6 months.
Okay.
Like December, it was signed a deal with Inkblot.
Okay.
It's another local production company.
Yeah.
Then a month later, in January, it was Ant Hill.
Yeah.
Ant Hill also produces movies that have gone. I had to be published on Netflix.
Yeah.
So yes, I think Amazon is here to run after Netflix. I think the steps that Netflix took first was acquiring Nigerian, was it a wedding party?
What's this like, movie again? Genevieve's.
Oh yeah, movie. Yeah. Lionheart.
Yeah,
yes,
Lionheart.
Yes, Lion, acquiring Lionheart before going ahead. To be fully part of the originals, yeah. You get.
Okay.
So, but Amazon is going the different
to
route.
The
like, yeah, it's going to the source. I think, I don't know, Netflix is not popular for. Netflix is popular, not for the sake of it. It's actually popular. A lot of people that actually are exposed to streaming online.
Yeah.
Goes through Netflix. I don't know how Amazon wants to do this. I've never thought of having an Amazon Prime account before.
That's because there was no Amazon, like they didn't have a serious presence. So unlike the e-commerce market where they are coming to fight established players, we can't say that Netflix is an established player in the market, because when you're practically the only person, you're not exactly an established player. How many people can we say have a Netflix account in Nigeria? So there's a large market.
There's a large market of people that would have had Netflix account if they had
the money.
Exactly. Yes. So it's not as if Netflix is not popular or people don't want to be on Netflix. People that share account, that share passwords, is because they really wanted to use Netflix, but they don't have the money. You get. Yeah. So Amazon coming in now, it's not as if the market the market's demography or the market's capabilities have changed. You get
that's an important point.
Exactly. So I don't know if Amazon has capability to actually drag audience with Netflix.
I don't even think it's a case of dragging audience with Netflix. I think it's a case of Netflix, so we can't see yet, but it would be interesting to know what they really are making from Africa or from Nigeria in this case.
True.
Right. So if they are making a lot of money, then Amazon might be like, okay, there's something here.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very small market. We can't even say that up to, I don't know if up to 1% of Nigerians use Netflix. Right. So if it's a young market, then they probably think there's something there for them. And compared to their e-commerce play, which I would love to know why they want to do that. If they go with Netflix current plans, you know, kind of, I mean, it's relatively cheap for most Nigerians, Abi. Not most Nigerians now, for some Nigerians, like maybe at 2,000 naira a month.
And correct me if I'm wrong, I think Amazon targets an elite population.
And do they? I don't use Amazon.
Even Netflix.
So you might argue a lot of things in Netflix's favor, but look at Amazon's resurgence in recent memory with really, really dynamic series like The Boys.
Is it Nigerian? We're talking about Amazon and Nollywood here. Please, let's focus.
And
and do something crazy in Nollywood.
Are we remembering Iroko TV that has moved? Like, their focus has also moved from...
To diaspora. Okay, to maybe. Diaspora. Maybe then the target of Amazon
would now be to produce with local talent, but with an eye on the diaspora.
On the, yes.
And something different that we've not seen before. I mean, for me, I think a lot of Nollywood movies in recent times have been trying to reuse tried and tested formulas. And of course, it works. But come on, just give us something different. I mean, Marvel reused a lot of tried and tested formulas.
So are you telling me that the content that Nollywood releases on Netflix now are not great?
Okay. That
can be argued.
Exactly.
Wait, but do you watch Nollywood movies?
Yes. The reason I watch Nollywood movies now is because they are on Netflix, not because they are on Netflix, but the Nollywood movies that are on Netflix now has a level of quality compared to what you've been used to. A way, having that platform makes them to probably want to do better.
Have you been watching Nollywood movies outside of Netflix recently?
Yeah, I have.
And nothing to write them about?
I don't know. I don't know if it's like a yes or no answer, but I've seen a few movies that are decent or more than decent, but I've also seen... So the way I'm looking at it now is that Iroko TV, competing with Iroko TV, are not really competing with Netflix. So talent is sort of cheap in Nigeria. In the movie industry, talent is cheap in Nigeria, at least to produce. This is not tech. This is not a purely tech role now.
Okay.
So you produce in Nigeria here, and then you target the Nigerian or African diaspora that keeps on growing. So the moment people leave, they still want that connection to home. And if they can target that section of the market, they'll still be able to make a decent dent in the market. I don't know. But as for getting into Africa or getting into Nigeria and competing with Netflix, I think there's still a chance for that because Netflix doesn't really have a serious monopoly on the entire market.
Yes, but it'd be interesting. But thinking of it now, if Amazon Prime decides to do like originals that are great and huge, right, and they take proprietary of it, which means that I can't find it on Netflix.
Yeah,
it might force me to go to Amazon Prime and probably create an account and subscribe
or share password.
That's one of the two. but yes, I think this is a move that I'm not seeing reason for the point you made the other time that Netflix has not gained a monopoly of the Nigerian market. It might be popular, right? Yeah. But Amazon going this extra length of doing originals in Nollywood, then I think it would attract people.
And it's really great for the talent because you had just Netflix to choose from, right?
Mm-hmm.
But now you have to choose between Netflix or Amazon Prime. You go for the person who offers you the best deal. So Netflix actually has their work cut out for them because I don't know the kind of deals they sign, but if they except you're signing a multi-year deal where if you sign with me, you can't work for another person. But I can be selling 2 to 3 movies to 2 or 3 different people. So
if Amazon Prime does signs an exclusive deal with Kula Fulayo, I'm ending my Netflix subscription.
Okay.
No, that would Amazon. Be unfair on the people that no please Kuna Fulayo, if you are listening to this, please don't give anybody monopoly, because I should be able to find my favorite movies anywhere. Don't okay. do this.
Okay,
well yeah.
hopefully but, I said you.
So is it possible to sign deals with, like, you create a net, you create a movie and then you sell to both Amazon and Netflix?
I don't think so. Probably it might be possible, but
yeah, it's possible. But yeah, yeah,
they'll make less money, Abi.
But maybe after a particular time, then you can now share. Maybe you could just say maybe after 2 years that it's been on a platform continuously, then that is when you can move to another platform. But please.
Well, this would be a good time, Sha, for you to launch your Nollywood career. You have a lot of people bidding.
Yeah, bidding.
Yeah, that's true. You know, you're talking about talent not being cheap. I think you're right too. I think you're right.
She's a struggle.
Okay, guys.
Focus.
That's an interesting one and an interesting prospect. And of course, if you are listening to this and you know Kula Fulayo, or if Kula Fulayo for some reason is listening to this podcast, please help Nifemi's life. But let me tell you, I don't mind. And
see, yeah. I have commitment issue.
See, only if the money is good, please go.
Exactly. I don't mind.
If I'm not loyal.
But if you feel like you like Nifemi, yeah, and you want to help her life, yes.
As a fan, I'm a huge fan.
Who Nifemi help?
Okay. Oh my God.
That was nice. We'll
continue
nice.
After we are done with this
podcast. Nice. I told you earlier today that the violence will go around.
Okay, everybody's collecting one by one. And if you're outside, please stay safe and try not to collect. It's not too safe. And of course, register for your PVC. Let's try to get things right so that all these projections we are making, we come to
end with us.
Yes. So that you can get an Amazon Prime account.
Exactly.
Yes.
You don't have to be sharing passwords.
Yeah.
And all of that. I mean, I'm just checking Netflix list. I'm seeing 30,000 subscribers in Malta, and Nigeria is not on the list. So, of course.
30,000? Like, Nigeria is not up to 30,000?
Yes, we don't have. No. So, don't worry.
Tank of Africa.
All right. So, yeah. So, if you're listening to us for the first time, you know where to find us. Google Podcast, Apple Podcast, Spotify, Teacher. Bolu, I'm sorry. I just started flowing.
just one day that was not yet. And you've forgotten about me.
Yes.
Don't feel bad.
I'm sorry. Yes. Okay. Do you want to take the other part?
Yes.
No longer.
Do you want to email us or tweet at us? Okay. You want to take it again?
I'll take it again.
Okay. So don't forget to share your thoughts with us with the hashtag Temple in Africa podcast. And so far, so good. We've not received any winner. So, Nifemi, your questions were too tough.
They were not. They are working on it.
I was saying it. Okay. That's still working on it. Should we give them to next week?
Yes, please.
Okay. So, we're giving you next week to win. Just go back to the previous episode, our 100th episode. Title Project Fella, and you will have a chance to win an awesome reward. Just go back to the episode and you have till our next podcast episode. If you don't win, I'm going to hold Nifemi responsible for
guys,
it.
Guys, save my head.
So yeah, and if you're listening to us for the first time, where can they find us, Bolu?
Okay, you can find us on Google Podcast.
Oh my God, Bolu. So you add your voice to ASMR on YouTube.
As I was saying, you can find us on Google Podcast, Apple Podcast, Spotify, Teacher, iHeart Radio, and anywhere else you get your podcast.
Bye-bye.
Bye,
everyone.
Google Podcast, Apple Podcast, Spotify, Teacher, iHeart Radio.